Assalamu alaikum. Kindly tell us what is the relationship between Adal and Ihsan, especially in view of the sermon that you once gave.
I delivered longish lectures in Jalsa Salana.
Yes.
You want me to deliver another lecture here?
No, I just want to know that how is it that Adal ke baghair Ihsan ho nahi sakta? This I could not understand.
You think it can be done?
No, I do not know the correct meaning of this.
No, what I said was right in the beginning that unless you establish adl, that is complete justice,
yes,
you cannot conceive of any ihsan. Ihsan must have a fundamental base of adl, otherwise it cannot be built. Because that ihsan, whatever you call it later on, is not ihsan. In the name of ihsan, something you do which is not ihsan at all. For instance, a mother can be kind to her own sons and you think it is ihsan, while at the same time she is being unkind to other wards which are her stepsons. So if she is being cruel, she cannot be a mohsina.
Correct.
So without establishing the fundamentals, one can't get to the higher rung of the ladder.
Correct.
That is impossible. This is what is meant by the Holy Quran when it first always repeats this in the same order. Adal is kept first and is paid greatest stress upon. Then comes Ihsan, then Ita'iz al-Qurba, which is a rare quality among the rare people of Allah. But this is the highest man can reach to.
Correct. There is adal maintained between the celestial bodies floating in the space. Similarly, if we throw a handful of pebbles onto this huge camera, some will strike, some will go astray. Every pebble has got its own circle, and they do not overstep each other. That is also adal. There is adal in every way in this life. Here Ihsan does not happen.
I have also spoken of this in my Jalsa Salana speech.
Right.
What is meant by Ihsan in the law of nature?
Yes.
There are manifestations of Ihsan in everywhere, in animate as well as inanimate creation. And that can be established positively, but not in such a short sitting like this.
Yes.
I think if you read the last speech of Jalsa Salana, there I have quoted quite a few examples of Ihsan in the universe.
In the universe.
Yes.
Jazakallah. Assalamu alaikum.
Anything else, please? Tell Muhammad Abdul Rashid. This is between you now, you are sitting close to me.
I have a question. He told me he has a question, but I don't know if
this
is the one that I don't mind.
You didn't give him a chance at all to say yes or no. He said something and walked up to
Would you like to come?
No.
In the Holy Quran, sir, in Surah Furqan, Allah Ta'ala has said, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِكْ تَخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ
مَهْجُورًا.
Could you kindly give us the background of this and which tongue is involved in this and which Nabi was involved, who was told this, please?
Ahmad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told that during the on the day of resurrection, our Rasul, that is Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, will complain to Allah that these my people, once having been bestowed the Holy Quran, left it and deserted it as unattended. This would be the complaint made against his own people by Ahadra sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but not people of his own time, but people of the latter days. Because there is another tradition of Ahadu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam which makes the whole thing very clear. He says, Yati alannasi zamanu lam yabqa min al-Qur'an illa ismuhu or la yabqa min al-Qur'an illa ismuhu wa la yabqa min al-Islam la yabqa min al-Islam illa ismuhu wa la yabqa min al-Qur'an illa rasmuhu, which says, among other things, that the Holy Quran will be only for writing and for the scripts to make beautiful writings out of it. It will have nothing to do with human life and modeling the character of Muslims. Only it will be a thing of ornament which the scribes will take pride and vie with each other that we write better and we write in gold threads and this and that. So la yabqa min al-Islam min al-Qur'an illa rasmuhu means nothing of the Quran will be left but the writing. So when this is going to happen according to his own tradition, and the day of the resurrection is after this, obviously this is what he is referring to. That an unfortunate time is to come when my own so-called people, followers, will desert me and the Holy Quran. The Quran will only be for the writings, and Islam would only be in name. La yabqa min al-Islam illa ismuhu.
So this, he said, will be one of the reasons for Hazrat Masih Maud to come?
Obviously, yes.
This is thing, see.
Could I ask you this?
Could he? This I was reading Tafsir Kabir, and I'll read a little bit from this and then question. Hazrat Muslim Maud Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu says, मेरे नज़दीक इस्लाम को इतना नुकसान किसी चीज़ ने नहीं पहुँचाया जितना नुकसान कायरा दमिश्क बगदाद बुखारा वगैरह ने पहुँचाया है। इन शहरों ने लोगों की तवज्जो मजहबी मराकज़ से हटाकर अपनी तरफ कर ली। अगर सबसे बड़े शहर मक्का और मदीना होते तो ये खराबी पैदा ना होती। यूनिवर्सिटियाँ बगदाद में बनी हालांकि उनका सही मकाम मदीना था। इसी तरह कायरा में बनी हालांकि मक्का में होनी चाहिए थी। बस जो कौम अपनी रूहानियत और इल्मी ताकत को फैलाना चाहती है उसके लिए जरूरी है कि उसका मरकज ही आबाद हो। Could you kindly explain?
This is self-explanatory.
Yeah, but you know, we made new centers for expansion, but over here, sir.
No, but they are sub-centers drawing their strength from the center. They don't shift the entire attraction of the center towards themselves and become centers at the cost of the original center. They are different things altogether. Sub-centers always come into creation when you spread out, but not at the cost of the center. If the nucleus is broken down and other nuclei are created, then in fact new animals come into being out of those nuclei. But if there is the central strong nucleus and small other sub-centers are also established within the animal kingdom, that is called growth of organisms. For instance, when considered the human being, there are billions of sub-centers in the body. Yet the main center, which is brain, is overpowering them and it remains the attraction of all those sub-centers. This is called organism. If you hit the brain and destroy it, then every individual center in the body would become the center by itself. And then it will be a dead body waiting for ultimate death. For instance, if you look at the slaughtered cow, you will see that much after it has the life has ebbed out of it, its sections like muscles in the thigh and other places go on trembling and showing signs of life. Because immediately life is transferred from the center to those smaller centers around. But then there cannot be any guarantee for its continuation. For a while it is just like a tamasha, it goes on, and then ultimately the life ebbs out from every other center as well. This is exactly the phenomena to which Hazrat Muslim Maud is referring, that had Medina and Makkah, the real centers of Islam, been the real true centers having all the power and ultimate attraction point of all the sub-centers, then these centers would grow in stature and in influence, and every other center would be a subservient center. But this is not what happened. They were deserted. They were given no importance from then on. The sources of attraction became cities like Baghdad and Bukhara and Samarkand, and you heard so much of their glory and grandeur that almost Makkah and Medina were forgotten, outshone by their later glories acquired by these cities. So this was when the bell began to ring, spelling danger, and nobody noticed. So Hazrat Muslim Maud had a very deep insight into the philosophy of history. So he's quite right when he says that. Now, the third question, or will you give a chance to anybody else?
Yes, sir, they have chance.
They have
chance.
Anyone wants to say a thing or two, please? Yes.
Hazur, the slaughtering of the animal, we slaughter by knife, and these people, they say that we should stun it and then slaughter it. And they say it's cruel and painful to the animal. How do we convince these people that it's not painful and it's not cruel to the animal by slaughtering the knife?
How do you do that? Tell me.
No, they stun it first and then slaughter it afterwards. So we slaughter straight away with knife.
That's right.
So
the fact is that when you slaughter with the knife, what happens is that immediately the blood supply to the brain is cut off, and the life rapidly ebbs out of brain, with the result that its power of sense and feeling is left without energy. It's failed out. So it is, unless somebody is slaughtered, he wouldn't know what happens to him. It's difficult to conceive in such a situation, but obviously, apparently, this is what we observe, that when the jugular vein is cut and the artery, main artery is also severed, then the main blood supply route is cut off. And when there is no power, there is no sense left. There has to be an energy to remain conscious and to feel. So that is the Islamic way. Now when they stun, the supply of blood to the brain continues, and nobody can guess what is happening in the brain. But we know this phenomena from certain patients who are drugged and made apparently unconscious. But during that unconsciousness, we know they have nightmares and highly excited activity of the brain. Sometimes they want to shriek and they can't. So we don't know what may have happened inside when they stun. So both are mute points. One can't be preferred over others. But one has the religious authority, other has not. One is told to us by God. So without deciding the fundamentals, how can we decide these minor issues? If it has been clearly laid down by Allah, and positively you can't establish the superiority of one system to the other, then obviously which comes from the source, if that source is really an existent source, then that should be preferred. He knows the inside stories of the animals he himself has created. So in this regard, whenever a religious phenomenon is to be discussed, then a religious comparison is to be made. Comparison with other religions. What is their instructions about slaughter? Then we will be within the realm of reasonableness. When you discuss these matters with these people who are irreligious, any system they invent has no morality and no deeper knowledge of the nature of life. So they cannot convince, they have no reason to feel superior because they have no real solid argument in their favor. Again, these are very small minor points of the irreligious world in the name of being less cruel to the animals, or in the name of being benign to the animals. They have these small objections against religion. But how they behave to the animals themselves, they completely forget. The whole life is made miserable for an animal which is kept for slaughter and raised for slaughter. If you see those houses where these animals are kept and raised for meat, they are almost straitjacketed there and made to eat and eat and do nothing. They are not even permitted to sleep enough sleep, because they think that if they are permitted to sleep more, they would eat less. So artificially, the days are created even in the night through strong lights. And they are not permitted to move, otherwise they will lose energy. So they have no life whatsoever left. And when they are killed, they say, let's be very benign and very kind to them. And we don't know whether they have actually been benign or not. They're just hollow people, nothing to support their philosophy. They're so cruel to the chicks. You see how they are brought in very small pigeon houses where they can't move. They are kept and fattened. This is the life they have permitted them. And when the slaughter comes, they wrangle strangle them to death and say this is a better way of slaughtering. While when you sever the artery, you know that immediately that feeling is finished. Moreover, there is much more pain in animal life caused by the laws of nature. So much so that simply you cannot avoid these things. So one quick last operation is a must. Now, any other question, please? Chaudhary Hayat Sahib, I think it's now your turn. You are justified. Your patience has to be rewarded. These two gentlemen prepare their questions, for the benefit of the rest.
Assalamu alaikum, Hazur.
Assalamu
alaikum. Hazur, we know that Khana Kaaba is the very first house of Allah Ta'ala, built by Hazrat Adam alayhi salam for the worship. Muslims are instructed to face towards it during their prayers, while previously the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his companions faced towards Baitul Muqaddas for some time. The question is, since when and why the Baitul Muqaddas was made the direction of prayer while Khana Kaaba was also in existence.
Mr. Adu, why are you sitting out of place? You used to sit here close to me. You wanted to hide the fact that you came late.
the bus was late, and so
I know that. But
yes, thank you, sir.
You couldn't hide that. Only yes. You missed the nearness, huh?
Yes. Thank you, sir.
So, this question, the fact is that it was the practice of Ahzur sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that unless a specific order was given from Allah, he would always follow the practice of the previous religion which had authority from Allah. And in those regions, the authority of Torah was in operation till the revelation of Islam. So this was his practice because he submitted to the will of Allah. And wherever he would find the will of Allah, he would follow it. He would not impose his own will. That was the greatest beauty of Hazrat Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Despite the fact that he wished otherwise, and it is mentioned in the Holy Quran, that we knew all the time that you did not like turning your face towards Baitul Maqdas to the exclusion of Khana Kaaba, yet you continued doing it. Why? Because he had no other authority. The authority of Bible, or let's say the practice of the followers of Bible, was to face towards their center, which was Baitul Maqdas, and later on where Masjid Ihram was built. So that was also a concentrated home for religious activities, and also Allah has spoken very highly of that center. So because the Israelites followed that center, Ahadzah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepted that. But while in Medina, while in Mecca, it was not difficult for Ahzur sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to include both Khana Kaaba and the general direction of Baitul Maqdas in the same line. Baitul Maqdas happens to be in the north of Mecca. And if you are standing south of Khana Kaaba, you can face both Khana Kaaba and Baitul Maqdas at the same time. But when Ahadra sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Medina, it was no longer possible. When he faced Baitul Maqdas, he was his back was turned to Mecca, the first house of God. This is what hurt him most. And this is why Allah Ta'ala told in the Holy Quran that we are seeing what is happening to you inside. So out of your wish, and this is also the straight path, now we are revealing that you can turn to that direction which was the first house of Allah. This is how it took place. And this is the philosophy why it happened so.
Please. It's not a question. I seek your forgiveness because I stood up and spoke without your permission. I'm sorry for that.
When?
Sir. Just a little while ago.
Did you? I don't remember.
I'm sorry, sir.
I don't remember at all. In fact, on this issue, on the issue of the illness of his wife, I beckoned you up to come and explain. No, you didn't observe. In fact, you did it at my behest. Now, Khoka Sahib or Salim, who is it?
Salim.
Salim?
Yes.
Aye, come on. You have also joined the company. You are one of the three now.
Thank you, sir. I have three questions, really.
Yes, this is what I meant. This is exactly what I meant.
One question is very simple, but this
but
is
the answer could be complicated.
No, I don't think so, because
okay.
We use this common use of the words Ahmadiyyat and Islam, but both are the same.
Thank you.
But
correct.
Why we use this?
When we say Ahmadiyyat, we want to declare that our concept of view
or concept of Islam is the concept of Ahmadiyyat. Because Islam has different concepts. Looking at Islam from various angles, it would change its complexion, sometimes fundamentally. Look at Islam from the angle of Brelvi vision, and it would appear to be a completely different Islam from the one which is being observed from the angle of Wahhabis or Ahl-e Hadith. And now turn to the Ahl-e Quran, and a new Islam would emerge. So Islam is only left one in name. Change the angle and a new panorama would appear before you. So leave the Sunnis out and go to the Shias, and the same thing will begin to happen there among their various sects. They differ so fundamentally with each other. So to tell the story of every difference held by the various sects is a very long process. But if you refer to your sect in name, what you do is, you help the listener to form his view about your Islam. But because people also call you non-Muslims and this and that, so immediately you have to tell them that it's Ahmadiyyat, that is the Islam. There's no difference between Ahmadiyyat and Islam. All we mean is that Islam as viewed by Ahmadis. Yes, please.
So the question is this, that is it permissible to pray for the idolater parents of one?
The Holy Quran categorically rejects this, so prohibits you. Idolaters.
Yes.
Yes.
It's not permissible.
Not at all.
So the one whose parents were idolaters, he prays in his prayers the Wale Wale Diya.
Yes. When he says walidayya, the word walidayya is applicable not only to his parents, but also to the parents and the parents, the whole forefathers are called walidain or walid. This word covers all the predecessors as well. But I tell you, no, I'm sorry. That is Abba. I'm awfully sorry. I mistook this word for Abba. Walidayya does not cover that. You're quite right. This is a very good point. So I'll have to think over it. When you say Abba, in that, of course, your predecessors are all covered. But Walidayya is a siga of tasniya. It all only speaks of the two parents which you had. So there are two aspects to this. One is, when you read the Holy Quran and go through this verse, then it is not a prayer which you make. It is referred to others and you read it as a story. The Holy Quran tells you that such and such person on so and so recited this prayer, so there is nothing wrong. Now, as far as a person is concerned individually whose parents happen to be idolaters, in the new prayer he must not recite this, nor outside the prayer. And the prayer can be complete without this prayer. This is a very fundamental point to be understood. If this prayer were obligatory, then this objection would be valid. But this prayer is not obligatory. You say Durood Sharif, and even if you say Assalamu Alaikum after that, without reciting the prayer Rabbana Atina Fid Dunya and so on, your prayer would be still complete, according to all the fuqaha. So these are prayers which are non-obligatory prayers. And the order of the Holy Quran is obligatory. Anybody who has parents as idolaters should not pray for them. So this is why no Muslim, if he happens to be the child of idolaters, must not recite this prayer in the this verse in the prayer. Right?
Third one.
Well, you thought of a good point. Thank you. I must congratulate you on this.
Thank you.
Very fine point you raised.
Thank you. Sir, it's not the actually question, but sort of question. That once I was talking with someone, and this point came into my mind that if Khatam means the Akhri, in the point of view of Paramedis, non-Amedis, so Allah should also have used the word Khatam for Himself.
For himself,
because akhir, awal o akhir. So that I point at that time I
no, was khatam, it correct? Khatam is only applicable in conjunction with others. When it khatam means whatever it means, something which is used as a possessive to others. Then according to some ulama, the meaning is the last. Khatamul Nabiyyin, Khatamul Khulafa, Khatamul Ulama, Khatamul Shura, Khatamul Atibba, Khatamul Hukama. All these make it a compound word. So the ulama say that when it becomes a compound word, then it has some other meaning. By itself, Khatam does not mean anything but this ring or anything with which you stamp a thing. So they are not debatable issues at all. Khatam by itself is not debatable. When it becomes possessive to some other plurals, then the debate begins. So Allah cannot be used as a khatam to other gods because there are no other gods. That's no argument.
My point was wrong.
Yes, obviously. That I wanted to listen. Thank you. Yes, please. Please, the symbolism used in the Holy Quran in describing the Garden of Paradise for the righteous.
The
description of the garden
of paradise.
What I started was that the symbolism used, like milk and clarified honey
and wine
and rivers. Now, what this my understanding in that description of Zul is that the mention of wine. And then the addition of a delight for those who are interested in wine as part of this description. While wine is prohibited. So I fail to understand that the significance of it.
Now, do you know why people like wine and drink wine?
They feel it helps them to forget their worries or.
They get intoxicated,
and then they forget.
So, if the Holy Quran tells you that the wine, which is given to you in the heaven, will have no intoxication, then what is the fun in having that wine?
Then there's no
no fun. Then this is not the wine which you refer to. The wine of this earth, of this world, is only drunk because of its power of intoxication. If Allah Ta'ala declares in the Holy Quran that the wine which I am going to give you will be without intoxication, then there is no prohibition left about that wine at all. It was not the same. Sharab means any drink. Unless that drink is intoxicant, it cannot be considered as wine in this terminology. So the Holy Quran says, Sharabam Tahura. La lagvam fiha wala tasima. That is that is Jannah. And in other places also it says categorically, you know, remember the verse where it says, that wine will not have any effect of intoxication. Pardon? That I have already studied, but that is about Jannah. La lahum fiha wa la taseema is about Jannah, about the wine itself. The Holy Quran says it will not have the effect of intoxication whatsoever. And also it is not the same milk, because the Holy Quran says... That I have mentioned already. Were you sleeping? I haven't mentioned. Another word which I have not mentioned. And the milk which does not stink and does not, you know, has no influence. Bacteria do not influence that milk. It does not go sour. That is the milk of Jannah. So it is something different. Everything is just symbolism. And the Holy Quran makes it very clear that we are talking in symbolism. Don't enter Jannah expecting to be given that wine which you are used to here, if you are used to.
The word sharab, you explained the meaning of it is any drink. But I thought previously that it is a combination of shar and a, evil water.
No.
That I previous
at all. Aab is not an Arabic word. Aab is a Persian word. So if it was a combination, the very combination was evil. Now, whose turn it is?
One little request, sir. As we all know, we have not got the Tafsir-e-Kabir of the whole of the Holy Quran. There are some chapters which are not completed yet. I wonder, sir, if you have some ways in mind to fulfill this big gap which we are having.
Every Muslim Maud has left some notes. And one of the scholars of our Jamaat wanted to write that tafsir, so I prohibited him. I said, it's not your job, because you may not completely understand the notes of Hazrat Muslim Maud. This is not just a mental exercise, this is a process of revelation, of a quiet revelation from Allah. This is how you do tafsir. It's not just your chalaki, your own cleverness that helps you any.
Yeah.
So whenever Allah decides, Allah will give this opportunity to someone to fill the blanks, inshallah.
No question, sir. I was asked this question by some non-MDs. He said that you told me last time when we met that we got all the answers in the Holy Quran. And then he was coming back on this. He said, can you answer this? He said, Islamic view about the unrest on the labor strikes in this country is causing a lot of trouble. If you can comment something or recommend something. I told him that there's a Hadith Sharif saying that...
No. Talk of the Holy Quran first.
Could you kindly please, yeah.
Huh?
Could you kindly explain your...
I've already explained it during my speeches on Adl. If you devise a just, equitable system of distribution of wealth, then there can be no unrest of any sort. And then, again, if you also give every class a code of conduct, which is based on the concept of absolute morality, then there cannot be any unrest anywhere. Everything just fits in into its own compartment, and there is no friction caused. Friction is always the result of interference, not without it. It cannot be caused. Interference means when the movement of one part, whatever that part be, a social part or a material part, begins to interfere in the sphere of another moving part. Then the friction is caused. And the friction by itself generates energy. which is most often a wasteful energy. Sometimes some devices are made on the principle of friction to harness the energy ultimately. That is a different thing altogether. But in moving parts, if you do not keep the motions in their own separate compartments without interfering with other parts, the friction will cause and ultimately burn up the machinery. So wherever in human systems, whatever the systems be, there are frictions. This is the fundamental reason. All other approaches are just superficial and meaningless. You must find out which part of that system has usurped the rights of other system. And that part should be stopped to that much, where it should not be permitted to interfere in the other's rights. If the answer is that you begin to enter into their sphere and usurp their rights, this will again cause some friction and it will go on and on. So what Islam has done is this, the Holy Quran itself, you don't have to go to other sources as yet. The Holy Quran is very clear that every class, every conceivable section of society has been given some rights, some prerogatives and some obligations and duties. And they are so clearly laid down that if you remain within your sphere of movement, then no friction can be caused. Why does not this friction found at the time of the early Islamic period, at the time of Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself? The fact is, the greatest of those who offered their love and sacrifice to him were from among the labor class. Who were Ashab al-Sufa? They were sheer laborers who had absolutely nothing as capital to them. And these were those who offered their lives and their time and every comfort for the sake of Islam, and they loved Hazrat sallallahu alaihi wasallam so much. Why? Because their rights were preserved and they knew that they would find peace only in this system. So when later on the Muslim governments themselves started deviating from the Islamic principles and started permitting one section of the society exploit the other, then these frictions came back again, in some cases with greater vengeance. But Islam speaks very clearly of these things. Islam speaks of the laborer's right, of the master's right, of the mutual understanding. And those rights are so clearly laid down and are in fact so much inclined towards the poor, the cause of the poor, that a labor society in an Islamic system would be much better off than a communist labor anywhere in the communist world. This is just not a claim. This is something which you can prove, like 2 and 2 make 4. The fact is that all that the communist system achieves is not the transfer of wealth from the rich to the poor. This is not what it does at all, anywhere. What it does is this, that it makes everyone laborer and dispossesses everyone of any individual property, with the result that the entire property of the state is not equally distributed. It is only controlled by a few who come through the party politics, which turns into a dictatorship ultimately. So all the resources of the state are left then in the hands of a few who have no moral standards, and they can dictate terms to any extent because they have become absolute rulers, because communism and absolute rule go hand in hand. One cannot survive without the other. It's impossible for communism to survive in a state where there is no absolute rule. This is why they are so cruel to those voices which are raised against them, even solitary voices in great empires are feared, greatly feared by the communist world. Why? If communism is a philosophy which has been accepted through experience by the whole state, why should not you permit to some scientist to raise the voice against the system? It's one of the greatest crimes, because they know that without absolute rule, communist philosophy cannot prosper. And why it cannot? Because what the communism achieves is not that distribution of equal wealth to everybody. The classes remain in operation. Only greater number of people become laborers without their own personal will and freedom and property. Everybody is turned into a propertyless person, at the mercy of a few who rise through the power of the party, and that then begin to rule their party, which was a source of their own power, mercilessly. And if they are not merciless, they cannot survive in this society. This is why Lenin had to be merciless, this is why Stalin had to be merciless, and this is why, according to their own observations, a communist leader who is not merciless, he cannot survive. So is this what you call labor-inclined system? In fact, labor has nothing left to itself. Why they are worse off, I can prove that as well. To some extent, if somebody is in a mood to listen to reason, he can be convinced of this. The fact is that in a free society, cruelties can be exercised against labor, no doubt. But where the government is different, this is not the ultimate possessor of the entire wealth, and the individual holders of property are different, then there is always a possibility of the laborers going to the government, raising their hue and cry against those individual parties and fighting for their rights. The government will be a third party then, not directly involved. So there is always a chance for the labor to fight for her right, to go for strikes, to go for public demonstrations against some cruel masters, against some cartel holders, and against some capitalists, to a government which is not directly involved in that. And because of democracy, ultimately because they have to go to the laborers and the poor classes for their votes, so they will always be inclined to help their cause. But in a communist society, there is an absolute rule. All the laborers, in fact every citizen, has been disinvested of its properties. The result is that you have to raise your hue and cry against the usurper, that is the government. And the government will not tolerate it. The result is, if they make a decision, they also see to it that no protest is made. Strikes are forbidden in the entire communist world. Poland experimented for a while, and you see what happened to Poland. So the Holy Quran does not claim a hollow system divorced from realities of life. The Holy Quran keeps in view the very human nature, the distortions which are ultimately acquired by human beings. Because nature is not distorted. Distortions are later on acquired by wrongdoings. So Allah keeps all these factors in mind and gives you a teaching which would create balance. Balance in the society, the maximum freedom and the maximum compromise between individual freedom and the state's interference. This is Islamic system. The Holy Quran is very vocal on these things, but these are such issues as cannot be discussed in such short times. But you can tell him with head held high up. That the Holy Quran is very vociferous on these matters and doesn't leave any detail out.
Could you kindly give us some hadith on this as well? And there's the issue coming up in this country.
The best hadith about the laborer's rights, not one hadith, there's so many traditions of the Holy Prophet establishing the laborer's rights, establishing the slave's rights, the household servant's rights, and telling you so much so that you should give them the same food which you eat in your houses. Don't make any distinction. You should clothe them with something like your own clothing as well. And the words used are such that no equal distribution is exercised. Only it is demanded that give them also a taste of the food you eat, give them also a taste of the dress you'd wear, with the result that Ahlul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself practiced such kindness to his own servants that they were treated like sons. And this is a long story, we will speak of that later on sometimes. About Hazrat Ali, it is said that once he walked into a shop for buying and there was a slave with him who was wearing a dress exactly like him, because he had received something from somewhere, he parted it in half, gave half to his slave and half he wore himself. And so it was difficult for the people to find out who was Ali and who was his slave, those who didn't know him. So he saw somebody important coming, people were turning to him and so on, but saw two people almost alike. So when, there's so many things which can be quoted in this regard. Then Hazur Akram Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has told us that before the perspiration of the laborer dries out, you pay him with his full labor. And always pay him. Then he says, pay him more than his dues, never less than his dues. If you pay less than the dues, then you'll be answerable before your Lord. So what is full dues? Again, that is to be decided. According to the Holy Quran, some principles are laid down, what the word full dues means. And then Islam sees to it that no exploitation is exercised in any sphere of economy. This doing away with interest is one of the very strong measures. Doing away with the cartel system is also another measure. So you can't treat one single item alone without going into the whole setup. So labor is just a part of a system. So not only Islam is very clear on the labor's rights, but also the very system which it devises is a system of justice and fair play. In that system, the laborer would be very free and happy, and his basic fundamental rights would be guaranteed. Also that of his children. And when Islam says that if somebody has a capability, it is the right of the state to build that capability. Everybody should be treated according to the gifts of Allah to him. That means a poor man's child, if he has capability to rise to a certain degree of attainment of knowledge and he has no means, it would be the responsibility of the state to see to it. So the laborer's children also are guaranteed that if they're intelligent enough and laborious enough and serious enough to rise to a certain station and the poverty stands in their way, then Allah will see to it that the Islamic State helps such children. And despite the fact that we have no government anywhere, we have so much financial responsibility despite our meager sources, the burden, financial burden on Ahmadiyyat is very great. Yet in Rabwa, we have demonstrated this type of Islamic attitude towards the poor, towards the laborer. Nowhere in the world the laborer is paid such attention as it has been paid here, the labor has been paid in Qadian or in in Rabwa, it is not only the fair distribution of wealth, it is also the fair treatment, the distribution of honor and honorable treatment for which the human beings vie. If you give somebody a bread and put him to a lower status, sometimes he would throw the bread away and fight for his right to be respected. This is why Marx once quoted here in London, writing to Engels, he said that bread is not that man lives for, because then he was there, he felt insulted, and then he thought that all the system which just talks of bread is not enough. There is something like human values, and unless you pay respect to the human values, it is not the bread itself by which you can live. He himself had to admit it. So in a society like Rabwa, you would see laborers who would be invited to the highest society in their parties, in their marriages, who are met at equal terms, who are requested for prayers by some rich people, and many highly placed people try to say Assalamu Alaikum to them before they do. They live an honorable life, and also during their marriages and things, very quietly and very honorably, people as well as Jamaat helps them, and their daughters become the daughters of the whole society in this sense. And they also attend their marriages. Some of the children of hard laborers, grave diggers, were educated because they were intelligent, and they rose to great heights. They became scientists and got established in some foreign countries, while no other grave digger can be treated like this anywhere in the world. And not only one, every child is a highly respectable member of the society, because the whole society paid that respect to that laborer. In Qadian, there used to be what was the name of the one who was called children Binitori, but by the others he was highly respected. Khudabash, yes. There was a laborer, Khudabash, and the type of labor Islam produces is a very honorable type. He was so fond of saying his prayers in the mosque that he would leave his labor alone and run from the station back to the Masjid Mubarak and say his 5 times prayers there. And the small children used to tease him, because he was very much annoyed when somebody called him Bhindi Tori. So he was called Bhindi Tori because he was bandied in legs. So, but that was, children do it to everybody, you know. As far as the grown-ups are concerned, I have seen people, very rich people, bowing before him with respect, offering some gifts to him and requesting him for prayer. He was a highly respectable member of the society. Where can you produce such a laborer in the world?